Folks from Maria Droste Counseling Services in Quincy entering their 25th year very soon, right here in the City of Presidents, offering treatments for substance abuse, addiction, and on a sliding scale basis, too, for folks who have a difficulty paying. Last month, they sponsored a special community discussion on the opioid abuse and substance abuse epidemic that's plaguing our region. That discussion continues this month at the Thomas Crane Public Library in a special three-part series called Community Learning About Addiction, Prevention, and Education, or CAPE. And Danielle Owen from Maria Droste stopped by to tell us more about it. Danielle, good to see you again.
Hi, Joe. Thanks so much.
Pleasure. Thanks for having the time to come over and tell us about this very important discussion that will be happening.
Yeah.
First of all, at Maria Droste, talk a little bit more about the mission, if you could, and what your goal is.
So our mission is essentially providing one-to-one individual and group and couples counseling for mental health and substance use. We have a very holistic approach. We're aware that mental health and substance use issues don't happen in a vacuum. And so we have a team of volunteers who also provide holistic services like Reiki and massage and things like that for folks who are dealing with major pain issues, which a lot of our clients who are dealing with opiate recovery, heroin and opiate recovery, find very, very helpful.
Okay.
So we're very much kind of like a safety net, really, for folks who are underinsured or have no insurance and otherwise would find it hard to access traditional services.
Sure.
So in a nutshell, that's what we're about.
Yeah. And, you know, I mentioned last month you hosted a panel discussion at the high school regarding substance abuse. Why did that forum come about? You know, what was the discussion at Maria Droste that led to that presentation?
Well, I think the biggest thing our agency really wanted to do was to let the community know that we're here.
Mm-hmm.
We've been here for 25 years.
Right.
And I've been attending a number of recent other outreach events earlier in the summer, and we realized that a lot of people were surprised to hear that we were there. We're right down Quincy Center, and I didn't know you were there. So in some ways we felt like we're kind of like the best kept secret of the city. So let's really put ourselves out there. There's a number of different forums that were happening all through the fall, and we said we really want to be part of that conversation.
Okay.
And also really part of the conversation focusing on the fact that everybody in the community is impacted, families as well as the individual, and different communities. We have a huge breadth of wonderful immigrants and people of color moving into the community now, and everybody is being touched by addiction. And we wanted to be very clear that we are here for everybody.
Okay. Matter of fact, you just had to expand your offices not too long ago because of the increase in folks you're seeing with substance abuse issues.
Yeah.
So I guess it's good that you were able to expand to be able to provide that
service,
but bad because you had to.
That's the truth. I mean, we would love to work ourselves into retirement. That would be great. That would be brilliant. But the reality is addiction has been with us for a really long time, and we've had very different policy responses to it. And so the panel was a great way for us to hear from people who are working in criminal justice, like Senator Keenan, who's involved in the legislative process,
mm-hmm.
you know, and how the policy then feeds down to how everybody responds to it on the ground.
Right.
And so it was a really great conversation. Great deal of hope. We left there with a great deal of hope.
Yeah, and a matter of fact, that's kind of the tagline, right? Is bringing hope to life. There is a way out, right? And there is help, and you're not alone.
No, I think if we can send any message, you know, the three-week course would be really helpful, but I think if people can leave each night feeling like, yes, it's really challenging, yes, it's very serious, you know, it impacts people in ways that they can never, you know, really imagine. But if people see that there is hope, that there is a way of responding to it, that people do recover, then we've done our job.
Yeah, let's talk about this. This is going to be happening on the three Mondays, basically between Thanksgiving and Christmas, from 5:30 to 7 p.m. each of those Monday nights. Mm-hmm. What's this all about, Danielle?
So one of our programs is called the Welcome Program, and it's a five-week program where anybody who is first time attending our services, you know, especially folks who are coming through the criminal justice system or on probation, on parole, it's their first understanding of how we approach addiction.
Okay.
for, because some folks might find one-to-one counselling a little intimidating at first, and so we found that the education program was a great way for people to get concrete information, ask questions in a safe environment, without without judgment, and just get them to think about making changes without any pressure. And we've had a great deal of success with that. And what we wanted to do was, you know, the panel is all fine and well, and we had a great response to it. But we wanted to do more for the community. And one of the key things I keep hearing from our new clients coming in the door and from families who call us on the phone is understanding what addiction is, how it happens, is this what's happening to me and my family, and what can I do about it? And so we felt if we do a tailored version, a shortened version of the Welcome Program, just giving highlights, people get a sense of, number one, how our approach is to addiction, which is, you know, in line with a lot of other centres in the area. But it gives people information. Mm-hmm. And you know, information is power.
That's right.
It really, really is. Yeah. And so when people feel that they have options, that there is hope, they're more likely to act, they're more likely to take steps. But it's in a way that we're very respectful of where people are at. And it's a topic that has a huge amount of stigma, huge amount of shame, and people don't want to be seen to be getting this support. So having an open community space makes it easier for people to come in and say, okay, just give me information. I want to go help a friend that I know, you know, but it doesn't matter what your reason you're there for.
Right.
Take the information that's relevant for you and use it to make a change.
Okay, that's week one, December the 5th, right?
That's right, December the 5th at 5:30. The first one, we're going to be focusing primarily on what addiction is, how we identify it. So if you met with somebody, what would be the signs and symptoms? Or if you were working with a family member, how would you know if they were struggling with addiction in the home?
Okay.
Because again, people find it very hard to tell you up front, this is what I'm dealing with.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes they're not even sure if that's what they're dealing with.
Sure.
They're blaming, oh, it's a depression, or maybe my loved one is struggling, you know, with just work, and they happen to be using alcohol to cope with it. Sometimes it's hard to know, you know, if it's the chicken or the egg is the problem.
Sure.
So that's what we're going to do. I try to incorporate more kind of videos and you know, cartoons and things like that, because I feel like it breaks up the information, so it's a little bit more easier to understand and take in. And we'll also have like handouts and things like that for people to take home and bring to family members.
Great.
The second one, we'll be talking in more detail about how change happens. We'll be using what is generally used in the addiction field as a motivational wheel of change. So it gives people a sense of, you know, how would I recognize how ready for change my loved one is, but also for family members. So we break that down and get a sense of how change happens and also what the potholes are in change. You know, we frequently hear of people who, you know, I've been through detox many times, I've been through this process many times, nothing seems to have worked.
Mm-hmm.
And the truth of the matter is, like any illness, it takes a few runs.
Yeah.
It's part of the process.
Yeah, it's not a linear path straight through, right?
Oh,
It's circuitous at best.
And unfortunately, because of the myths that are around the illness, people feel like, oh, I failed treatment, you know, I failed treatment.
Yeah.
And the reality is treatment has failed you.
Yeah.
You know, that there's so many other ways that we can get you through this process.
Sure.
And so, you know, looking at what those potholes are, how we'd identify them and how to prevent them.
Okay.
You know, like getting treatment for depression, if depression is what brings you back to the alcohol use.
That's December 12th.
And that's December 12th. And then the final night, we're going to be focusing really a great deal on how families are impacted.
Okay.
You know, treatment programs are great about supporting the individual. Gradually, more programs are coming on board with the focus on the family. What we're learning from the research is that when families are engaged in treatment, even for themselves, and recovery for themselves, the loved one is more likely to access treatment.
Okay.
So we see it as a preventative piece as well.
Interesting.
You know,
okay.
It's generally, once you get somebody starting, there's a domino effect on treatment recovery.
It's like somebody in your family who's trying to lose weight may inspire somebody else to join
it.
Yeah, okay.
Exactly. Because you see people doing better.
Yeah.
And change can be really challenging.
Yeah.
And so having support while you're going through that is really the best way to deal with it. So I think one of the things we're going to do on that night as well is talk about what fellowships are out there, what supports are out there.
Okay.
You know, people are familiar with AA and Al-Anon and Nar-Anon, but there's some like smart recovery, there's like Learn to Cope, there's The Sun Will Rise, there's a number of great support agencies and nonprofits out there for all sorts of reasons. So we really want to let people know that they're out there.
And there's a reason you're doing this right around the holidays, isn't there?
Yes, yeah. Absolutely. Traditionally, I'm doing this 16 years, and traditionally, you know, November, December, January tends to be a really fraught time, especially for families. We tend to get a lot of calls. Mm-hmm. People are very fearful, and individuals are very fearful because there's a huge pressure to have the perfect holiday,
right.
You know, and the reality is there's no such thing. And families
right.
are, nobody has the Brady Bunch, you know.
Even It's a Wonderful Life had its tribulations.
Right, absolutely. It's yeah. a really hard time.
Right.
And I mean, you know, so at the end of the day, if we're able to give people some ideas so they can have hope to get through the holidays, we yeah. can't promise that massive change is going to happen from attending.
Right.
That would be irresponsible. But what we can promise is there'll be some seeds sown. And so hopefully, and January is a great time. People do a lot of, you know, New Year's resolutions.
That's right. Yeah.
And so this might be a way to kind of fuel some change for the new year, get people thinking about for themselves or
okay.
for their loved ones. But it's generally the one of the most vulnerable times of the year for people. So you're right. It was a very deliberate decision.
Yeah. These are all free, and you can attend them individually or all three if you'd like.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Just come for one, come for all, doesn't matter. You know, as I say, it's free, it's non-judgmental.
Right.
We'll have a process where if people have specific questions they don't want to ask in public,
right.
They could be able to write them on index cards, and I'll respond to them either during the session or afterwards.
Okay.
But we really want people to bring the questions that they have,
right.
you know, that maybe they feel like they can't ask their doctor, they can't ask a psychiatrist.
Yes.
We're happy to try and respond.
Great. Well, thanks for coming over and letting
My
us
pleasure.
Know about this. And
thanks so much.
Hopefully have a great turnout at these sessions, Danielle.
Sure, we will. Thanks for your support.
Oh, you're
really
welcome.
Appreciate it.
Pleasure. And if you'd like to get more information about this or any of the programs at the library, go to their website, thomascranelibrary.org.